Our story starts from the African narrow dirt path, and we will be told around the warmth of a campfire. It includes 3 tons of elephant, a warthog that lost part of his bum last night, and a gang of cheeky Padras monkeys fiddling with the telescope while we took our coffee this morning. Quite the games rats play when the cat's away. But no, that's not all. With the support of some amazing friends and partners, in July this year, Charles, Brian Jonathan, Brian and I set out on a journey to see, touch, test, and experience a new world. And with our cameras, we promise to bring this to you. We call this a new world because that's what we experienced, most of which we could not capture on camera, but was incredible in every way. All experienced travelers and working in the travel and tourism industry, we thought of a hope journey that would not only bring back memories and lift the lid off some new experiences for safari lovers, but one that would also remind folks working in the tourism sector that it was and isn't the end of the world, despite the current times. For that very reason, our wild journey of 14 days was dubbed the best job ever. And here's a bit of flavor from the road, a journey around what's been called the Pearl of Africa, and what we prefer to call home. So let's rewind to where it all began. On the 18th of July, we fueled our tank and left Kampala, the capital city, for the eastern part of the country, starting a hope journey around Uganda. Fourteen wild days, 4 local travelers, 4 wheels, who knows how many kilometers we would cover. It is a special feeling driving through the east, through an ancient rainforest called Mabida, across the Nile River, very close to its source, the very point where it lands to flow, on towards Mbale town, which as I speak, has been upgraded to city status. Having topped up our gas tank, we headed further east into the mountains to a place called Kapchora. There's something about this part of Uganda that deserves a lot more credit. It's the origins of some of the world's best coffee. It's the undulating terrain, carpeted in green, that has birthed world champions. It is the welcoming and happy people. It is a whole lot more. We came particularly to see Sipi Falls in the foothills of Mount Elgon, an absolute stunner, arguably the most beautiful waterfall in Uganda. 2 knowledgeable local adventure guides would lead us on a tour that would take us through the communities to some of the most romantic sights you'll ever see. We had planned to just go by briefly on our way to Pianope Wildlife Reserve, but Juma and Job Sister B stayed the night. The view that evening of the wild plains disappearing into the distance below was spectacular and definitely one for the books. It's well worth spending a night or two in this peacefully magnificent place, which also allows you time to enjoy some excellent walks and abseil to the show-stopping descent of the main drop, which Charles so bravely did on our behalf. There are three falls separated by steep hillsides. Though the upper two are beautiful, it's a 95 meter main drop that attracts everyone.
Ready for the trip, and Uganda should be your first destination to make it all the way down to Africa.
The second waterfall, as we say, is the most romantic waterfall because it has got a man-made cave, which allows us to enjoy and watch the waterfalls behind the scenes. Cheers, guys. We hope to see you soon.
In the morning, we beat both the sun and the rooster to the wake-up call and were headed north in pursuit of Pian Upe Wildlife Reserve. Little known, but big everywhere. The diaries of Pian Upe go back 2 years ago when the three of us, apart from Charles, had embarked on our maiden journey to uncover this, Uganda's largest wildlife reserve. Our last visit had given us 101 reasons to include this wild and remote protected area on this hope journey. Uganda has many places where you should enjoy a bird eyes view whenever you can, and Pian Upe is one of those. We had to send the drone up to film our grand entry into these historical lands. With our temperatures checked and our hands properly sanitized, the warden received us, and we were then shod to our rooms. I and the boys are not the kind to arrive to comfy beds. Our thirst for the wild sent us right into the bush with Daniel in search of some of the treasures of Pian Upe. The food would definitely wait. A muddy mid-morning walk brought us to Napedet Cave, an ancient site of great significance to the people of Karamoja.
Right now I'm on top of Napedet Cave. As before I told you, when you're on ground climbing on it, you'll imagine that it is an elephant lying on the ground. And right now I'm stepping on the head of an elephant.
If the cave with its elephant shape does not intrigue you, then the ancient giraffe paintings on its walls will. And so will the views from atop the cliff. From here, we could see the endless expanse of unspoiled savanna, guarded by the high-standing Kadam Mountains, the many outcrops and hills. This place was rich in wildlife and rare mammals, and there is the Girigirik River that feeds animals with a sustainable supply of water and the communities an abundance of fish. There's always something new to see here, including the newly translocated giraffes that were unfortunately farther than we could reach in a single day's excursion. Brian proposed that we would return to this very spot in the evening to watch the sun retire. Quite a great idea. I proposed that we brought some coffee along. Everyone called it a deal. The last time we were here, we had spotted cheetah, zebras, hardbeasts, elands, and the rare roan antelopes that are only found here in Uganda. Our journey back to camp was to fill our tummies, empty memory cards, before we could return for an evening game drive, and of course Brian's plot to stalk the sun. The grass was high this time round, and the trails had become impassable due to the recent rains. We had been warned, but we insisted.
Yeah.
It didn't take long until we had abandoned the mission to find cheetahs and leopards, and were walking to set our mini camp to watch the sun set. You totally can't miss me. Some stories are better not told, but we'll tell them anyway. The one camera that we thought would last ran out of battery just as we were arriving at Napedet, so we obviously missed to capture the sunset. And then the drone crashed into the rock, just as we were trying to capture the same. Who must have annoyed the gods that day? The sunset that evening was unlike any I have ever seen, and probably will ever experience. Quite sad that we were unable to capture it for you to see. Well, one thing that would not go wrong was the coffee. We enjoyed that and returned to the headquarters. Daniel, our ranger guide, will tell you that short journey back to camp was one of grumbling. Four upset travel photographers that had seen but missed the sun. Let's save that story for another day. A campfire was in order that night to get the team back in the right mood and to plan the next day's escapade. The following morning we rose with the sun as it left its resting spot behind Mount Kadam. A lovely thing to watch unveil before your eyes. Breakfast was served with ostriches surveying the grounds. It did feel royal. It was sadly time to say goodbyes and head farther north towards Moroto. The journey that should have lasted 3 to 4 hours involved meeting a broken bridge. That meant we would have to turn around and go several kilometers to find an alternative route that had us lose a full hour of driving time. Cut the somber mood. It was still an entertaining ride. Journeying through Karamoja land, watching vibrant villages waking up, kids walking animals to graze, while women rode to the market, and the hills that trapped us was a reward for the eyes. I recall we had to stop twice for the necessary health checks before getting to Moroto town. It was so encouraging to see the standard operating procedures actually in place. Very soon we were making the turn onto Adiebo Dodoth Road and arriving at Karatunga Karamoja Safari Camp, where we were received by a doggy. Okay, not exactly. Theo Voss, a good friend and stickler for the Karamoja sub-region, was our host to receive us.
Very
Today we have two activities. One in Uganda, mountain bike tourism is not yet super happening. And here in Karamoja is the best place actually to cycle. It's a bit flat, a bit hilly. We have beautiful mountains here, and especially our culture. So we cannot let you go without at least testing our mountain bike tours.
Yeah.
And we have one of our best mountain bike guide here. Yes, we call him the small god.
Do I have to be an expert rider?
No, you don't need to be. Oh. Because the advantage of adventure tourism is that you just go, enjoy it. You don't need to go to that professional aspect of joining the competition. But at least you're fun and discover.
With our bellies well fed, it was time for the Karamoja Mountain Bike Tour, a unique way to discover the untouched northeast of Uganda. We rode over old colonial roads, enjoyed the views of undulating plains, interacted with the local community, and immersed in one of East Africa's richest regions. In the evening, Theo and his team treated us to a scenic walk through the lush valley of Mount Moroto, the highest mountain in the whole of Karamoja. And here we met the Tepeth mountain people, an incredibly fascinating lot. The Tepeth are considered the original inhabitants of the Karamoja Plains, but were pushed high up the mountain by the current settlers. They were formerly hunters and gatherers, but due to the decline in wildlife numbers between the 1970s and 80s, they have since taken up a new role as agropastoralists. For so many years now, they depend and worship Mount Moroto, upon which they attach the greatest cultural, spiritual, and economic respect. Like their close relatives, the Karamajongs, the Tepeth live in grass-thatched structures called manyatas, an intriguing and unique form of African architectural design. Our walk climaxed in one of the most beautiful evenings on the trip. Did I say we had the Tepeth dancing a few meters away, a sunset before us, Mount Moroto behind us, a campfire and warm Karamajong blankets awaiting us, and then there was yummy stuff to munch on, plus some bush bun tales from the man himself. Hiking and sundowning in the mountain is a unique way of learning about the peoples of northeastern Uganda, from its highlands to the vast plains below. We retired back at camp, and in the morning had a short chat with Theo.
What I'd like to do is to thank the Best Job Ever crew to give us the opportunity as Karatunga to show, I think, Uganda's best kept secret, being the region of Karamoja, the northeastern corner of Uganda. Uganda has more to offer than gorillas. And there's also really a unique culture, a preserved culture, and an untouched environment tucked in the northeastern corner of the country. I'm half Ugandan, half Karamojong, and then half Dutchman. I came here 4 or 5 years ago by now. And I came actually to discover my roots. This pandemic is, I think, a good lesson for all of us. I hope the future of tourism is going to be more responsible, more sustainable. But believe me, it's coming back. Discover Karamoja. But Uganda for sure is a pool of Africa.
Our time was far spent, but there was just one last dance. Florence, our tour guide, led us through Kautakor village, bringing us very close to the lives and livelihood of the people of these ancient and authentic lands. Decades of isolation and conflict made the Karamoja sub-region of Uganda unthinkable as a destination. Until now, today Karatunga develops authentic cultural experiences and outdoor adventures throughout the region, aimed at creating job opportunities, preserving cultural heritage, and the natural environment. It was great to see them going strong despite these unprecedented times. The time was now to say goodbye. Kitepo Valley National Park was inviting, and we couldn't resist her charms. We had all been to Kitepo before, but not through the eastern route. And it's right to say that for all the years of trips to this park through Gulu and Kitgo, a lot had been missed. For most of the way, what was the highway, seemed like we had lost our way. We drove right into the sunset and on towards our home for the following 3 nights. Adere Safari Lodge. Adere gets its name from a local instrument and is the newest addition to lodge properties in the Kitepo area. From here, the sunrise is best enjoyed from your private balcony or the main lodge deck. The food was, as they say, mwah. Whatever Simon had going on in the kitchen was consistent magic for all the days we were there. Like the places we had been to, it was awesome to see that this locally owned safari lodge, though new, was bracing themselves for the new normal. But in addition, they had a lot more going on to prepare for when the gates reopened.
We have been having maximum maintenance, renovation, all above the lodge. And we have also introduced SOPs. Adere comes from a Hatezo verb, meaning a calabash. So actually a calabash is used in different ways. Like as Karamojongs, you use it for drinking a local brew called Kwete. And in actually people, they use it as an umbrella for young children. And sometimes also they use it as an instrument for their traditional dances. Kidepo comes from Adodo's verb, Kidep, meaning to pick. Actually, the first people to stay in the park before the park was gazetted in 1958 as a game reserve were the Ik farmers and the Dodos pastoralists.
Charles says Kitepo was his favorite spot on the itinerary, and here are a few reasons why.
You're most welcome to Kitepo Valley National Park. Kitepo Valley National Park is one of the 10 national parks we have in Uganda. The park is rich in biodiversity. How are we doing it, especially in this COVID period? Uganda Wildlife Authority, in the consultation with the Minister of Health, have availed to us the standard operating procedures, and I want to assure you that we are observing them. Right from when you come to our gate, you'll find our staff who are very ready, equipped. We are keeping the social distance, and we have been having visitors, and we are trying to observe the standard of operating procedures. And of course, you are subjected to temperature testing before you are allowed to enter the park. While in the park, our guides have got sanitizer. They sanitize the vehicle before you enter. They sanitize you. But we have hope. We have labored to take care of the animals in the wild. The lions, the giraffe, the cheetahs, we have continued to keep the facilities clean. You can actually see our banders here at Apoka. Our tour operators, the Ugandan citizens, the foreign residents, and who are able to travel now, we are very ready to serve you. Feel free to come. We are here at your service. Otherwise, I want to take this opportunity to welcome you to Kidepo. Feel free and enjoy the rest of your stay in Kidepo.
Having been received by the tourism warden into the remote and less traveled plains of Uganda's third largest national park, it was now time to head out in search of the wonders of the true African wilderness. We saw elephants, zebras, giraffes, warthogs, monitor lizards, vultures, leopards, reedbucks, waterbucks, rock hyraxes, porcupines, oribies, hartebeests, elands, and as Brian Jonathan says, swarms and swarms of buffalo. Oh, I almost forgot those two lion sightings. Two big males in the open plains, and a queen resting majestically on her throne. On one of the mornings, we enjoyed a nature walk with Gilbert, our Uganda Wildlife Authority guide. Those were mixed feelings for sure. Walking and hearing leopard calls from very close on foot, and the thought that a pride of lions would be nearby kept our adrenaline rushing. And then there were the fierce buffaloes who seemed to smell for our exact coordinates. They say they are the most dangerous animal in Africa, but that's not true. We are. Years of conservation efforts by the Uganda Wildlife Authority have ensured that poachers are convicted, wildlife populations rejuvenate, and tourists get to enjoy safaris of a lifetime. Walking in the wild plains is a special way to see the true African wilderness from both large and small screens. The mountains of Karamoja, as well as those of South Sudan, were in view, and so were the littlest of details. The wise men say, in Kidepo you can smell the rains from many kilometers away. The rains in this part of Uganda feed the two rivers, Kidepo and Narus, which form the lifeline of one of Africa's most endeared wildlands. In the morning you may cross a dry riverbed, and a few hours later, on your way back, you could be driving through its seasonal stream. On all of the four game drives in Kidepo Valley National Park, we enjoyed every sighting in the absence of congestion. All encounters were private, intimate, just us and the wild. It's easy to see why it is still considered one of Africa's most remote national parks, and a secret that's been best kept. Four days and three nights flew by like a shooting star, and it was sadly time again to pack up, say our goodbyes, and head on towards the famous Makshun Falls National Park. The journey to Makshun does not prepare you enough for the awesomeness to expect. In Africa, rain is a sign of good fortune. The rain is often a sight for celebration. In our case, it created the perfect transition from the northeast to the northwest, our opportunity to meet the Nile River for the second time. We went through Gulu Town for lunch and to fix a mini mechanical issue. Upon getting to the Tangi Gate to Makrim Falls, it was the usual procedure: test temperatures, sanitize, and register. Only that this time round, two elephant bulls were close to the gate to welcome us as well. We drove in and on towards our home for the next 2 nights, Pakuba Safari Lodge, a popular name for safari lovers. With its beautiful history that is better served for when you visit, Pakuba sits in a serene location and commands by far the best views of the Albert Nile from its eastern bank. That welcome juice every time I'm here knocks differently. With all formalities done, Victoria, the lodge manager, gave us a bit of insight into what they had going on during the lockdown, providing every reason to return very soon.
When we opened in November 2010, we just had a few blocks and we had a few guests then. The tourism industry was not as strong as it is now, which means we also had a few staff. Right now, we have over 40 staff members. We can accommodate over 100 guests in this lodge. It's very vast. It sits on 1 square mile. So there is a lot to see. The animals come until our doorsteps. So it is a sight to see. This pandemic has impacted a lot on both hospitality and tourism industry. So we thought, why not take the opportunity of doing some kind of renovations and cleaning up. We kept ourselves really busy. And apart from that, of course, we had some recreation activities every evening by the pool. We kept busy during that time and still with the hope that something good would happen. But we never lost hope. As somebody once said, we are in this together. So we believed if we're in this together, then we can fight it together. All this we learned during this COVID time, and yes, we put it into action. The housekeepers are very aware of it. They will disinfect the doors, the doorknobs, the beds. Pakuba Safari Lodge would like to give a reassuring message, a message of hope. Yes, you are our people. We are open and we are following the Ministry of Health SOPs. The tourists out of the country, please remember, if you cannot travel now, you can travel later. So there is no need for you to cancel. We believe we are going to manage this. And we welcome you all to Pakuba Safari Lodge.
One thing we really loved about Pakuba is that the game drives begin right as you drive out of the lodge. Needless to say that the wildlife, especially the waterbucks, elephants, warthogs and cobs, love it here. Leopards and lions have also been sighted very near, and you can't miss the resident clan of nodding geckos. So you can see a whole lot without going very far. A kind of armchair safari. The game drives were what we had asked for. Elephants, hippos, some of its 460 species of birds, antelopes, and a leopard high on the tree, and the giraffes that are hard to miss. It's not news that the official lockdowns and the loss of tourism revenue has created new challenges for protecting Africa's wildlife. It was obvious that the loss of an additional deterrent, the tourist vehicles in the parks and reserves, would embolden poachers. We did realize that Makrim Falls, like many of the national parks, had faced extra pressure during the lockdown period, on one of the evenings we sighted illegal fishermen, and the rangers were able to bust the plot by some poachers while we were there. Emma, our ranger guide, mentioned on one of the drives that just because a park may be closed to tourists does not mean their work stops in any shape or form, reaffirming that Uganda Wildlife Authority was committed to fully managing the parks and reserves even during the unprecedented episode of lockdown. And with the reopening of the wild places, a breath of fresh air is steadily returning. Every reason to directly support conservation efforts through donations or by planning your safari soon. The future is positive. Who comes to Uganda's largest and most famous national park and does not do the 17-kilometer cruise to the bottom of the mighty falls after which it's named? It's one rare opportunity to encounter water wildlife and semi-aquatic creatures as they chill in the mighty Nile, while other wildlife draws to the banks of this great river to quench their thirst. Definitely a National Geographic kind of scene. Milton, our skipper from Wild Frontiers, was kind enough to bring the boat to a sudden stop, allowing us a few minutes to take some photos before a hippo bumped us from the bottom, a signal that it was time to move on to the next sighting. If you've not yet been or heard, the waters on the Nile this year have risen, like in all other parts of the country. And it was no surprise that our boat could not get as close as the boats would often do. For all past visitors to Makshan, the view from the bottom and the top always blows you away. With the rising water levels, it was even more stunning. This point where the Victoria Nile crashes through the rock and descends dramatically towards Lake Albert is an unforgettable sight. Our voyage led into the Rift Valley escarpment of Butiaba and further south towards Bugoma Central Forest Reserve, where we were warmly received by the fine team at Bugoma Jungle Lodge. The last couple of days had been hectic, and we needed just the right place to rewind, revitalize, and rejuvenate. The Bugoma area, with its greenest scents, the fresh air, and the stillness provided just the perfect respite we badly needed. At the edge of a forest under threat by a proposed sugarcane plantation, we thought of a chat with Constantino Tessarin, the managing director of Bugoma Jungle Lodge, and through whose passion for the preservation of nature, an association had been formed with efforts to protect this delicate biodiversity reserve.
We are here at the Bugoma Jungle Lodge. In fact, we are at the outskirts of Bugoma Protected Reserve. So this is actually the first lodge for tourist accommodation in the area. Bugoma Jungle Lodge, being one of the properties of Uganda Jungle Lodges, follow the policies of Uganda Jungle Lodges. Ecotourism, eco-lodge. As you will see, all the type of structure, the type of material, the type of architecture, it is everything typical. This is now a forest lodge. So the main tourist attraction here is the forest, is Bugoma Forest. And it offers at the moment nice nature walks, with the possibility to see some of the endemic primates. Endemic because there are some, like the Uganda mangabe, which is endemic and typical only of this forest. Uganda Jungle Lodges and Bugoma Jungle Lodge have been re-energizing during this period, thinking about how good will be a new nature experience out of a pandemic mood that has taken us through a strange period. During the period of the last few months, we have taken an opportunity of rest together with the rest of the nature. We have been observing the area. We have been particularly continuing with our project and our plan of assisted tree planting. We also remain very vigilant about the arrivals and the presence of people at the lodge. So we also introduced a system of double check and double cleanliness, adding some new products in our system of cleaning. The experience of Bugoma Jungle Lodge is parallel and it goes really together with the experience of the Association for the Conservation of Bugoma Forest. We are still today in Save Bugoma campaign 2020, and we still believe that this forest, in the pandemic mood of today, should be part of our recovery plan.
With a night of very good rest, we each planted a tree as our commitment to protect the environment, and were quickly back on the road, driving towards Kibale Forest National Park. Along the way, we met a team of Uganda Wildlife Authority staff picking up rubbish on the frontiers of Kibale Forest, a reassuring sight that there are still people out there doing their job, despite the not-so-good times. As the sun began to set, we were arriving at our perfect home in the trees, Turako Treetops, where we were received by Nicholas, the lodge manager. With our temperatures tested, sanitizing done, and dinner orders taken, it was time to see our beds, but just for a few minutes. Nicholas had a bit more to share with us, so our naps could wait.
Yeah, Turako Treetop has been operational 2 years ago, and it's an amazing hub to track the chimpanzees and other primates like black and white colobus monkeys, red colobus monkeys, and red-tailed monkeys. And we're just neighbors, and it has 8 rooms in total, the same luxury cabins, which can host between 1 to 4 persons, depending on the sleeping arrangements. They are unique and really classy rooms that one should really not miss out. Some of activities that can be done here, one, there is relaxation. There are walks ranging from forest walk that is done from here, and a number of trails that you can enjoy from here. There is as well a night walk, which is arranged from here, and a lot of things that you can see, especially the nocturnals and cats. COVID has affected us in a number of ways, but we would like to thank all the domestic tourists that have managed to show up at Turako Treetops, and we are encouraging many others to come. The word of hope is that nature has not changed in any way. It's still safe and contact, and we are trying to do our best so that today, tomorrow, when they show up, everything will be fine and they'll be able to enjoy at their best here in Kibale Forest National Park. To operators and tourists in Uganda and abroad, you're most welcome to Turako Treetop, and see you soon.
The following morning, we woke with sounds of nature right outside our private terrace, packed our equipment, and were headed for some adventure. Along the way, we visited a good and old friend of ours, Charlotte, popularly known for her Diary of a Muzungu, who narrated her story of the lockdown and how staying on the frontier of the primate capital, Kibale, had been a delight.
Hey, hi, my name is Charlotte Bowaza, Bambita Nagawa, of Nchima clan, and I am a travel blogger. I have a blog called Diary of a Muzungu, and I'm a travel writer as well. I've updated guidebooks and I promote the region, but particularly Uganda. And I'm a trainer and a marketing manager as well. But lockdown has found me here on the edge of Kibale Forest, which has been my home for a couple of years. And I have to say, I really feel like I've won the lockdown lottery. It's been amazing, and every day I'm happy to wake up here. It has the most fabulous bird song, and I wake up every morning at dawn chorus just to be, you know, brought alive by the wonderful sounds coming from the forest. And sometimes it's chimps and black and white colobus monkey this morning. Last night I went to sleep hearing an elephant almost outside my house. And of course I have pinned down, I admit, because all my clients are in tourism and I've had to postpone my training workshops. I've really had to shift my attention, and so I've got much more into writing and to studying the forest, and I've learned a lot of bird life. I've become not an expert in butterflies, but I know a lot more about butterflies than I did you know, at the start of lockdown. So that's given me a greater appreciation of the forest, and I hope that will give me really good content when I want to promote this region in the future. And we're here in the Healing Garden on the edge of the forest now. And we were just saying how lovely it smells this morning. And this is free for the community to use. And this, it's the point of In the Shadow of Chimpanzees is giving the community something that makes them appreciate conservation and tourism. And other things here, there's going to be a butterfly garden soon. There are nature trails that employ local people. We have a former poacher who is one of the site guides. So we are really trying to improve the environment, conserve it, and give opportunities for local people as well. So yes, this has been a period of reflection. Uganda is an incredible place for tourism. We've got so much potential. We keep talking about it. This is a blip, you know, this is a pause, but sometimes that's good. And, you know, good time to think and reconnect and develop your networks. And we also want to promote sustainable tourism more, I feel, in the future. It's been a lot of talk about sustainable tourism during the pandemic, and let's say after the pandemic. And it's one of my passions, and I hope that here in Uganda we can take it more seriously and mainstream it into our businesses. And it's simple things like making sure that you don't litter, and not having plastic water bottles, having refillable bottles.
With primate tourism still on hold due to the risks of transmission of COVID-19 to our very closest relatives, we chose to instead take a day's excursion to watch Toro Sebliki Wildlife Reserve and Sebliki National Park. The Toro Sebliki Wildlife Reserve is Uganda's oldest protected natural area, having first been set aside in 1926. It was once one of the best stocked and most popular wildlife parks in East Africa, but it suffered significant poaching during the Civil War years. Wildlife is, however, slowly recovering, and you may encounter waterbucks, reedbucks, bushbucks, chimpanzees, pygmy hippos, buffaloes, leopards, forest elephants, and hyenas. There has been news of lions also being recently sighted. We had lunch at Nyati Game Lodge on the shores of Lake Albert before cruising further towards Sebliki National Park. Spanning an area of 220 square kilometers, Sebliki National Park rests on the Rift Valley floor, connecting Uganda to the steamy jungles of Central Africa, and thus harboring some really astounding wildlife. Although sightings were not easy because of the very thick vegetation, we visited its most famous primordial hot springs and geysers, which are sites for traditional rituals for the local Bamaga people. Well, Ua preserves a ritual of their own. From a short menu of eggs or banana plantain, you can boil and have a quick snack close to Uganda's lowest point. Both spots are a delight for birders, including a number of Albertine endemics. Both protected areas are situated in Toro Kingdom, one of the most dominant monarchies in Uganda, and among the country's most beautiful locations. Looking down from Kabarole Hill, the Karuzika is worth a visit, partly for its 360 panoramic views of the tourism city. This place is the residence of the King of Toro, who ascended the throne in 1995 at the age of 3, and is still the youngest king in the world. Like its many tourist sites, the palace has guides who will relate the history of the kingdom and explain the ceremonies that take place here. Kabarole loosely translates to mean, let them see. A kingly phrase to show off the beauty of his lands. From here you can see the Mucho administration block, which houses the kingdom's parliament. We received a royal reception into this great kingdom by the Deputy Prime Minister and the kingdom's Minister of Tourism, Honorable Joan Els Kantu Adieri. On behalf of His Majesty, Rukirabasaija, Dr. Oyonyimba Kabamba Iguru, Rukidi IV.
The Kingdom of Toro is welcoming you. The Kingdom of Toro is appreciating all that you have done. Thank you so much. With the tourists, we've looked after you before. We can look after you during, and we'll look after you after. What I want to tell you is that there's one word or two words that I want to give you. Tuko tayari. Tuko tayari Uganda. Tuko tayari Uganda. Fort Portal. Tuko tayari on the Toro Kingdom. Please come and enjoy the usual hospitality, the usual good people, the uniqueness of the Toro Kingdom. I bring you greetings from His Majesty Dr. Oyo Kabamba Iguru, Rukidi IV. His Majesty's vision on Fort Portal Tourism City under the Minister of Tourism are to promote cultural tourism, restoring and reviving our wetlands, water bodies, forest under his environmental conservation campaign, which he started a while ago and act as tourism sites. His Majesty is passionate and determined to set up Hospitality Training Center, which is a center of excellence, to enable the Batoro, to enable his young people to acquire adequate skills to take advantage of the tourism opportunities. Construction of hotels or grades to provide enough accommodation. His Majesty is passionate on developing our local airfield, or even for that matter, an international airport at Saka to provide a quick travel in and out of the kingdom. His Majesty is also focused on redeveloping all Toro Kingdom's cultural sites to boost the tourism. The government should have a comprehensive plan for the tourism city, which should be put together in this consultation with all stakeholders in Toro, where the kingdom is the main stakeholder. His Majesty wishes all of you good health, especially at the time of COVID, encourages you, young, old, to follow and continue the preparations and the deliberations of all the forward way to the tourism city. Long live the King, for God and my country.
Our journey led on towards Kasese Town and to Queen Elizabeth National Park, where we would stay at Buffalo Safari Lodge. Just as we thought we would arrive and relax a bit, we received a call that a lion had been sighted high in a tree, very close to the lodge. By now you probably know what happened. Resting would be for the night. Back at the lodge, a delicious meal was served, some indoor card games, and we were off to bed. Here's one lodge where you can't wander off in the night, because the wild comes uninvited. From our secluded cottages, we could hear a lion roar for at least 4 hours in the night. Could it have been the lion in the tree? The night did feel kingly. In the morning, we had a brief conversation with Francis, the proprietor of a local destination management company, and the director of Savannah Lodges, the chain of safari lodges that includes this one.
We have 13 rooms and we're going to build more 7 rooms around October this year. So by March next year, we'll have about 20 guest rooms. Of course, globally, since tourists are not moving, we've not had international tourists, but we've had foreign residents. We've had local Ugandans as well. So that is helping to keep the lodge running, pay its bills, which is a good thing because at the start of COVID, we never expected anyone to come. But I noticed that the level of confidence is increasing from visitors. I think people have realized that COVID is something we should live with. It's not a death sentence. Of course, we should maintain the usual standard operating procedures, social distancing, masks where needed, especially in crowded areas. Right now, there's a training ongoing for 2 months for our staff. They are training in shifts. Our marketing now is focused to the local market, and we've seen an increase in interest, confidence, even among local people, not as individuals only, but also as groups. So we also have an isolation room for anyone who exhibits signs, but for now we've not had any. We request that we do social distancing, masks, those who can, and as you've seen, all our staff are putting on masks. So this is one place in Queen Elizabeth where you see the wild animals in the comfort of your room or balcony. So it is not something we just talk about, it is something that is existing. And I believe there is social distancing between us and those animals. The 2 meters, I think we've really kept them, so we encourage the people to come.
Our chat with Francis was cut short by an untimely visit by 2 elephant bulls, who I guess had missed tourists for a while, and were back to welcome them. While in the northern part of the park, we also stayed at Elephant Hub, overlooking the unguarded plains of Queen Elizabeth, with distant views of the Kazinga Channel. The lodge also offered the ideal location to slow down a bit, offload our memory cards, and do a bit of post-production. Rukia, the reservations and marketing manager, hosted us to a coffee around a campfire.
Thank you so much, Rukia. Thank you so much to your entire team for having us. But it is good that we sit around the campfire to share final moments, and also to listen to the sounds of nature. And And of course, above all, it's good to see that we are social distanced, right?
Kinda, we could say that, yeah.
Yeah. So, Rukia, while we're here, we've been on the road. We've just been asking and also just experiencing what the tourism product is like in the COVID period, and we've realized that there are quite a number of changes that have happened, and I would like to pick your mind on what particular changes have happened at Elephant Hub as a result of COVID.
Well, we are doing a lot right now. A lot is going on, not only in terms of, you know, upgrading this facility to the required, you know, standards of all our guests.
Yeah.
We're also working together as a team to comply with all the standard operating procedures set by the Uganda Tourism Board. So we're trying to cope up with every little bit, step by step. As you know, we look forward to restart tourism very soon.
Everyone feels like that.
Yeah.
I see you have quite a lot going on. Are there what have you been doing during this period? What's the day been like at Elephant Hub?
Well, my team, she's Stella, she's been doing the overall supervision, and Rita, they've been around to supervise the construction of new cottages. We're looking at them as a luxury in Queen Elizabeth.
Yeah, I see.
And we're making an infinity pool so that when you arrive at the lodge, you relax while you have the best view, the panoramic view of the national park. It's really going to be an amazing time when our guests come back, because we have a lot packed for everyone right now.
You've got to visit the Ishasha sector of Queen Elizabeth National Park, especially on a road trip around Uganda, and we weren't leaving that out. The long journey from the north to the south involved us meeting chimpanzees, monkeys, and baboons. Ua led us through the Akatoche Gate after the usual COVID-19 prevention processes, which by now we had become very used to. And we were now driving to one of Uganda's finest retreats, Ishasha Wilderness Camp. Somewhat off the beaten path, in the far southern sector of the park, Ishasha is famous for its population of tree climbing lions. It's one of the few places in Africa where lions are known to hang out in the trees and are often found lazing on the sprawling limbs of fig trees during the heat of the day. We weren't fortunate enough to spot any during our time in Ishasha, but we had some cool sightings, including two male cobs that seemed high on testosterone, as well as what we liked to call the Great Topi and Buffalo Migration. Ishasha Wilderness Camp is one of the few lodges inside the park's boundaries. There is great wildlife guiding. There is a resident group of bachelor buffaloes, and you may spot Henry the Hippo on one of the days. We shared a word with Paul Goldring, the owner, with views of the Ntungwe River behind us. We arrived at Ishasha Wilderness Camp just as they were receiving their first group of guests, and it was a delight to share in a sundowner with drinks and snacks, followed by a bush dinner under the African sky. Fourteen wild days, four travelers, four wheels, about 4,000 kilometers, and wherever we had gone, it was a sense of happiness and an almost tangible feeling of conviviality. Everywhere we went, we felt welcomed. We saw a lot changed for the good. SOPs in place, lodges improving their accommodations, wildlands rejuvenating, roads being maintained, new trails being developed. There's a lot of new awesomeness out there. My ultimate highlight was seeing the readiness of the many destinations and how all this fused together to give us the most complete tourist experience ever. Of course, we missed the mountain gorillas and the chimps because at the time of the road trip, primate tourism was still on hold. But venturing along some unusual paths and mixing these up with some popular spots gave us an even bigger perspective of how beautiful a country we have. We all had our highlights.
From the mightiest of mammals to the littlest of bugs, some of the most brilliant waterfalls and some stunning landscapes. It's been an incredible journey.
My best moment was when we went to Semliki Game Reserve. That I think that was my best highlight, when passing through tracks that are actually not there, but we managed to get in. Then we went into ditches, getting out. So it was unique, and the national park is emerging, it's growing, even though people think it's not, but there is so much to see there. The hot springs are very unique. And of course, the north, passing through the feeder roads and finding the Karamoja region is all beautiful.
Glad I was on this trip, 14 days, four wheels with three of my best companions traversing Uganda. My favorite highlight is from Moroto. It's an amazing place, you wouldn't believe. The culture, the tradition, the rolling hills and the mountainscapes and everything. This tour around Moroto town, it's just an amazing feeling. Crossing through the paths and the lines of our heritage is just nice. The paddocks, the cattle kraals, then the thorny pathways. It was just an amazing experience.
We've seen a lot of amazing places, most especially Eastern Uganda is really a must-visit destination. Chidepo Valley National Park stood out for me because of the sightings we had. And not everyone has been able to see all of them in one visit, just one visit. But our stay in Chidepo was really a memorable one.
And Uganda is ready for you please come explore Uganda. The SOPs are all in place. Uganda Wildlife Authority has put everything in place for you to come and explore the destinations.
So keep adding on the memories, and Uganda will be a must-visit destination for every traveler who comes to East Africa or Africa at large.
As someone who really loves the bush, I must say that I've never felt Uganda as alive as I've felt over the past 2 weeks. And all I can say is Uganda misses you, and it can't wait to have you back.
For the tourists out there, both local and international, the country is ready for you. It's been an amazing experience, and we hope that you will have the experience to travel too and see Uganda to the fullest. It's no longer travel tomorrow, but it is travel now.
We would like to say a very big thank you to our unrivaled list of partners, without whom the trip would have been a huge challenge. Special thanks to
Soft Power Communications,
Uganda Wildlife Authority,
Goma Jungle Lodge,
Kartunga Karamoja Safari Camp,
Elephant Hub,
Nyati Game Lodge,
Matoke Tours,
Levels Kitchen,
Sippy Falls Guides,
Turaco Tree Tops,
Exclusive Camps, Wild Frontiers,
Uganda Tourism Board,
Adere Safari Lodge,
Natural Technologies,
Braka Tours,
Buffalo Safari Lodge,
Pakuba Safari Lodge,
Panda Studios,
Rome Safaris,
Go Explore Safaris,
The Virtual Tourists. You guys have been amazing.
3 different leopard sightings, 4 different lion sightings, plenty of bird species, some of the most stunning landscapes and sunsets, and the many smiles along the way. All we can say is Uganda misses and can't wait to have you back on the road very soon.
My name, Manager of Quality Assurance, Uganda Tourism Board, board that is mandated to promote and market destination Uganda to the rest of the world. We are here to say that Uganda, we are ready for you. Uganda, we can promise you and say that we are a very safe destination. In the face of COVID, Uganda Tourism Board and the Ministry of Tourism, Wildlife and Antiquities developed standard operating procedures right away from the airport, and this cut across the entire tourism and the value chain, cutting across the hotels to operators, to our guides, to our products. All we are here to do is to serve you and make sure that everyone lives a desired experience, at the same time, a memorable experience, putting safety on top of it all.
My name is Ahereza Blessing, the General Manager, Levels Kitchen and Rome Safaris Tour and Travel Company. Currently, we are handling only local tourism. We are taking people to national parks and all these beautiful places in the country. So as to keep everyone safe, we sanitize all the time. However, I believe there is hope for us. I believe the pandemic will soon vanish. I believe that our lives will come back to normal. And trust me, after this whole storm is over, we will be ready and waiting for you. The hotels we are in touch with, our partners are waiting for you. The national parks, the waters, the roads, the beautiful mountains are waiting for you. And we are also waiting for you. After we beat this pandemic, we'll be glad and very glad to have you.